I think we should have shirts printed out that says the second apron is not a place to be, right? As far as the restrictions, it's important.
I feel like we can tighten that up.
Yeah, we can. I don't know if it will fit all across on my shirt here.
What jumps out at you to start with this CBA? I'm guessing it's probably that second tax apron and the impact that's going to have on higher spending teams.
Yeah, there was already a first apron in place. What the league has done is put a second apron in place. So there are a ton of restrictions in it, and it certainly impacts teams like the Golden State Warriors, the Los Angeles Clippers, the Miami Heat. Those are the three teams that are kind of dangling in that second apron right now. And their league is kind of squeezing teams as far as limiting, as far as how they can go about and acquire players. We saw Brooklyn acquire James Harden and send out $33 million and take back the Harden contract that was 40. Like, that doesn't exist anymore. The Norman Powell, Robert Covington trades, those type of trades would be restricted moving forward. The other thing, and I think important for you to touch on with the second apron, is the draft picks, right? As far as how teams are impacted when it comes to their draft picks.
100%. Yeah. When you go into this second apron at any point, your draft pick 7 years out, the last one that typically you can trade, gets frozen. You can no longer trade that at all. If you do trade that before it happens, it operates much like when a team uses the non-taxpayer mid-level or acquires a player in a sign-in trade. Now, it does, in fact, hard cap you. That comes into play. And then what happens if you exceed the tax, the second apron, more than two times in the next 4 years?
Yep, exactly.
It goes to the very end of the first round. And the genius of the strategy from the NBA's standpoint in terms of making this as hard a cap as possible is we're talking 7 years out. So if I'm going into the second apron now to try to win a championship with Steph Curry in his late prime, I don't know how good my team is going to be in 7 years. Nobody has any real idea of that. So this could be a lottery pick that's going to the very end of the first round. And that's why, to me, this is going to start to act as, you know, a real hard cap rather than just a way to prevent teams from continuing to add talent to their roster.
I think the one thing that's interesting too is that you're not going to be able to trade cash in a deal. So if you're Golden State next June, and you're looking at, you know what, the 34th pick in the draft looks awfully nice. Maybe we can find the next Draymond Green there. We're going to send Orlando $4 million. Like, that doesn't happen anymore. And I was talking to a team, and they said, you know what you're going to see probably is more football-type trades. Unfortunately, there's only two rounds, right? So it's not like there's eight rounds here where you're going to say, you know what, I'm going to trade you two of my twos for, you know, a pick this year, where you're kind of jockeying more picks. But as you know, eventually you run out of second round picks.
Let's also talk about the extension piece of this, because yeah, I think that's important as well. So, you know, the limits that we have seen on veteran extensions are going to be lifted a little bit. Tell us about how that changes things, particularly, you know, the Boston Celtics with Jaylen Brown, Atlanta Hawks with DeJounte Murray, some of these players who, you know, have been unable to extend thus far because of the fact that the limits were kind of less than their market value. How does this change that?
Yeah, so the current rule under the old CBA was that you can extend for 120% off the last year in your contract here. So for a guy like Jaylen Brown right now, his extension, if the rule was in place this July, it would be 4 years, $165 million. Now, that's less than his max number. Of course, if Brown earns all NBA, we're not having this conversation, because his super max number is like $285 million here. So for Brown, the difference is from 4 years, 165, to four for 189. So there's a $24 million difference just by increasing that percentage from 120 to 140%. I think the other thing, Kevin, too, is that's interesting is that as far as these extension rules, is that a player, a rookie on a rookie scale contract who's going into his extension year, which would be going into the last year of his contract, only players who signed a max extension, Zion Williamson, Darius Garland, Ja Morant, could sign a five-year deal. That rule is now eliminated. So if you're Tyrese Maxey in Philadelphia, you can sign for 5 years and it doesn't have to be the maximum extension allowed.
You know, one of the things we do know from history, when we go back to when the last CBA started, we didn't know exactly how it was going to play out with the Supermax. And we've seen all sorts of impacts with the John Wall and Russell Westbrook Supermax contracts getting traded. There'll be plenty more to unpack in this CBA over time. But Bobby, thanks for sharing your expertise a little bit on what we can expect from it as we see it ratified, expected today.
Thanks, Kevin.